Inner Traditions Audio presents Origins of the Sphinx, Celestial Guardian of Pre-Pharaonic Civilization by Robert M. Schoch, Ph.D. and Robert Bauval. Read by Micah Hanks. Preface by Robert M. Schoch. The idea for this book originated in Bulgaria. It was late July 2014. Robert Bauval and I had been invited to study various ancient megalithic structures in the Rhodope Mountains, fieldwork that was subsequently highlighted in a documentary produced by Bulgarian National Television, which aired in February 2015. While having a meal on the outdoor terrace at the Momčilgrad Hitzhata MG Hotel Complex, Bauval suggested to me that together we should write a book on the Great Sphinx. I immediately took to the idea. The Great Sphinx, that magnificent and iconic monument, arguably the greatest and most recognizable statue on the face of the planet, has been central to each of our lives for decades. Independently of one another, although we have been friends for many years, we have studied the monument from different perspectives, yet we converge on the same conclusion, that there is something severely amiss with the standard Egyptological story of when and why the Sphinx was carved. It made good sense that we should bring our analyses together between the covers of a single volume. This book is a true collaboration, but it is also the product of two different scholars with different backgrounds, training, and experiences. We decided that it would be best, truest to our personal integrities and points of view, to keep the authorship of each chapter and appendix separate and distinct. Thus, you will find two different perspectives, chapter to chapter, as you listen. We believe that these voices harmonize and combine together in a complementary fashion. Likewise, in a few cases, there is some slight overlap where similar themes and significant features are visited and discussed by each of us, again from our own perspectives, and each confirming the work of the other. For the scientist and scholar, confirmatory analyses are relished and are the sine qua non of good research. To accompany our words, you will find a number of photographs and other illustrations in the accompanying PDF, including various antique images showing relevant details that are now obscured or totally lost to time. We have also provided various appendices which strengthen the text and delve into certain details that are too technical or too obscure to be included in the main body of the book. Each of these appendices can be listened to on its own as a standalone article, and indeed, several were originally written as such. However, they also complement one another and the chapters of the main text. With the appendices, the thoughtful reader has the material to delve deeply into and evaluate the evidence on which theories of the Sphinx are based. In essence, with this book, we have provided you, the reader, not only our analyses and conclusions, but also much of the essential data and the conceptual tools to come to your own conclusions. As is the case with many things in life, the more energy you put into something, the more you are likely to get out of it. With this in mind, you can approach this book as a good read, focusing on the chapters, or as an intellectual challenge, digging deep into both the main text and the appendices. Either way, our desire is that you will come away from this book with new insights and revelations regarding the Sphinx. Chapter 1, The Great Paradox, by Robert Bauval. Quote, "It has been the theme of poets, painters, musicians, theologians, and historians, and yet in spite of all that, it remained the silent mystery of the ages, the great paradox, being at once the best known and the least known of all the monuments in Egypt." Unquote. Salim Hassan, Egyptian archaeologist, 1953. Quote, "The exact period of construction, or better still, creation of the Great Sphinx, is still one of the great enigmas of the Egyptian art history." Unquote. Rainer Stadelmann, Director Emeritus of the German Archaeological Institute in Cairo, 2003. A Mystery in Stone. Of all the ancient sites in the world, none have so much awed, inspired, and mystified generations than the pyramids and sphinx of Egypt. These monuments, which stand on the Giza Plateau, have survived for thousands of years and may indeed still be there when our own civilization has long gone. It is as if the image of the pyramids and the Great Sphinx is encrusted in humanity's collective memory, and everyone everywhere, from the very young to the very old, recognizes them at a glance, even if they have never been to Egypt. The very words pyramids and Sphinx are enough to evoke a deep sense of mystery, of thoughts of life after death and eternity, and of a transcendent connection between earth and sky, and between the secular and the spiritual. Yet despite their universal notoriety, no one knows for sure what this mystery in stone is all about. The Giza necropolis is, quite literally, history's greatest paradox, and this paradox is particularly true of the Great Sphinx. Egyptologists say that the Sphinx is the effigy of a king, and nearly all believe that its face is the face of the 4th dynasty pharaoh Khafre, builder of the second pyramid at Giza. The combined man-lion, they say, is symbolic of the king's intellect and strength. To be fair, some Egyptologists do allow themselves a margin of speculation and see the Sphinx as a symbol of the sun god or the warden of the Giza necropolis, but that is generally as far as they will go. There is no real mystery here, they assert with confidence. We are tempted to say that the jury is still out, but truth is not democratic, no matter how many experts stick to these conclusions and the consensus. So despite such apparent confidence, the truth is that the questions of who built these magnificent structures and, more importantly, when and why, are still largely unresolved. Gateway to the Stars and the Select Place of the First Time. First, let us clarify some confusing terminology that is used today by Egyptologists. Giza is not just the site of the pyramids and the Sphinx, but also a suburb of Greater Cairo, which extends from the west bank of the Nile to the edge of the Sahara Desert. Foreign tourists automatically assume that Giza means the pyramid area, but to the inhabitants of this area, the Giza necropolis is known as Al-Haram, meaning the sacred place. As for the term necropolis itself, it comes from a Greek word meaning city of the dead, conveying erroneously that this place is an ancient cemetery, a concept that would have been seen as reductionist and even alien to the ancient Egyptians who created it. You will often hear Egyptologists calling this place the horizon of Khufu, but this too is misleading. The ancient Egyptian term was Akhet Khufu, which does not apply to the whole Giza necropolis, but only to the Great Pyramid. Furthermore, the term Akhet has a much deeper meaning than simply horizon, and has more to do with the afterlife form of the king as an illumined spirit, or perhaps more accurately as a star soul. So what should the Giza necropolis really be called or seen as? In my opinion, it should be seen as a sort of gateway to the starry world of the Egyptian afterlife. The same terminology misconceptions involve the words pyramid and sphinx. These are but crude Greek derivatives or puns, where pyramid comes from pyramides, meaning large cakes, presumably given by Hellenes, who visited Egypt in late antiquity. The ancient Egyptians, however, called these structures mere, which, according to the eminent British Egyptologist Sir I. E. S. Edwards, means the place of ascent. As for the term sphinx, this, too, is a distorted Greek rendition of the Egyptian term Chesifong, meaning living image. The term Chesifong, however, was not exclusive to the Great Sphinx, but was also used for other effigies of sphinxes in general. The Great Sphinx itself was specifically known as Horemaket in the New Kingdom, circa 1500 to 1150 BCE, and much earlier in the Old Kingdom, circa 2700 to 2200 BCE, is Horakhti, both being subtle variations of the epithet Horus of or in the horizon. This is confirmed in the inscriptions found on a large stela that butts on the breast of the Great Sphinx, the so-called Dream Stela, as well as those found on many votive stelae, where both names are mentioned. Some also name the place as Setep, the Select, and in the case of the Dream Stela, more specifically as the Splendid Place of the Zeptepi, where Zeptepi translates literally as First Time, a sort of golden or primordial epoch, also known as First Occasion, when the gods ruled Egypt. Egyptologists naturally consider Zeptepi a mythical idea, a sort of Egyptian Genesis set in an imaginary pharaonic Garden of Eden. But as we shall see, Zeptepi may have been a real epoch that was ingrained in the memory of the ancient Egyptians who developed the Giza necropolis. American Egyptologist Richard Wilkinson was of the opinion that from very early times, the Egyptian civilization had, quote, three great themes, original cosmic structure, ongoing cosmic function, and cosmic regeneration, which may be seen to be recurrent in Egyptian temple symbolism, unquote. And in a similar vein, British Egyptologist Rundle T. Clark argued that all rituals and feasts in ancient Egypt were, quote, a repetition of an event that took place at the beginning of the world, i.e. Zeptepi, unquote, and that, quote, the basic principles of life, nature, and society were determined by the gods long ago, before the establishment of kingship. This epoch, Zeptepi, the first time, stretched from the first stirring of the high god in the primeval waters to the settling of Horus upon the throne and the redemption of Osiris. All proper myths relate events or manifestations of this epoch. Anything whose existence or authority had to be justified or explained must be referred to the first time. This was true for natural phenomena, rituals, royal insignia, the plans of temples, magical or medical formulae, the hieroglyphic system of writing, the calendar, the whole paraphernalia of the civilization. All that was good or efficacious was established on the principles laid down in the first time, which was, therefore, a golden age of absolute perfection, before rage or clamor or strife or uproar had come about. No death, disease, or disaster occurred in this blissful epoch, known variously as the time of Re, the time of Osiris, or the time of Horus. Unquote. All this would suggest that the most appropriate name for the Giza necropolis should be something like the select place of the first time. However, for convenience and to avoid confusion, we will nonetheless continue to use the terms Giza necropolis, pyramid, and sphinx, not because we sanction them, but because they are the terms used in all modern Egyptology literature. At any rate, let us imagine the Giza region as it might have been before humans came to it. In other words, let us begin our story on a clean slate and set the timeline back to that mysterious epoch of Zeptepi. A Room with a View. In 2005, my wife, Michelle, and I rented an apartment on the fourth floor of a modern building that overlooked the Giza necropolis. My intention was to spend a few years in the vicinity of the pyramids and the Sphinx to research and write a book, The Egypt Code, commissioned by the publisher's Random House. Being there on location, I was hoping that it would stir my imagination to see what this area might have looked like before anything was touched by human hands. I guess I was probably inspired by the words of Paul Devereaux, a research fellow with the International Consciousness Research Laboratories group at Princeton University. He wrote, quote, by coming to see the landscape as it was to ancestors, full of mythic imagery, memory, spirits, and powers, one reaches back to deep springs of consciousness. It is an effort that can rekindle a valuable, if now unfamiliar, relationship with the natural environment. Unquote.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.